Echo and Harper Audio present My Heart Laid Bare by Joyce Carol Oates, performed by Danny Campbell. If any ambitious man have a fancy to revolutionize at one effort the universal world of human thought, human opinion, and human sentiment, the opportunity is his own. The road to immortal renown lies straight, open, unencumbered before him. All that he has to do is write and publish a very little book. Its title should be simple, a few plain words, My Heart Laid Bare. But this little book must be true to its title. No man dare write it. No man could write it, even if he dared. The paper would shrivel and blaze at every touch of the fiery pen. Edgar Allan Poe, 1848. Prologue. The Princess Who Died in Old Muirkirk. She was not a Londoner by birth. She was very likely not even English by birth. You could hear it in her voice. Sarah Wilcox. Sarah Hood. 19 years old, small-boned and ferret-crafty, eyes of no particular brightness, hair of no particular beauty. Yet she was her lady's favored maid. Her lady's most attentive maid, listening at the children's lessons, French, Latin, music, numbers, the kings of old England and France, listening at the children's prayers, paying heed to her lady's friends in the great houses and royal palaces. How to incline the head, how to lift the voice. The eyes rolled delicately heavenward, as if God on his throne were gazing down. Ah! An innocent flirtation. Before her lady called, Sarah knew to obey. Before her lord gave a command, Sarah knew to acquiesce, having, as it seemed, no will of her own, surely no cunning. Albeit Sarah was not her name, and in her voice you could hear she was not a Londoner by birth, very likely not even English. One day Sarah swept to her lady's golden mirror, bedecked in her lady's most exquisite finery, silks, jewels, hair pieces, and made so bold as to inquire, in her lady's very voice, Is it little Sarah, or her lady who stands here so proud? Whereupon the mirror laughed, saying, Your lady, little Sarah, was never so proud. And shortly thereafter, her lady and her retinue were summoned to the great palace at Warwickshire to visit servants she was royalty, and all trembled in awe of her. Old Jeremiah was charmed with her high, pure, faultless soprano voice. A child grew in her womb, but it soon turned to stone. Now the old man repented of his sin. Now the old man begged of God forgiveness. He had no use for Sarah's Latin, or her French, or her fine embroidering, or her tears. And now Jeremiah died of flames raging in his throat. And Sarah fled Marblehead in the late winter of 1775. As York, as Winthrop, as Talbot, her long fair hair bound up tight beneath a gentleman's hat, and her slender body craftily concealed in gentlemen's clothes. In Rhode Island she gambled at cards. In Delaware she followed a river south to her father's bedside. What seek ye, Sarah? What and where? In Maryland she revealed to admiring eyes that she knew all the dances of the English court. Her feet were small, quick, high-arched, her lovely head was high, her eyes ablaze in young womanly beauty. In ballroom mirrors in the great houses of Virginia, there was reflected a hundredfold the graceful figure of Princess Susanna Caroline Matilda. And did the sweet English visitor not charm her hosts with tales of her sister the queen, and her brother-in-law the king, and numberless intrigues at court? And did she not charm all who gazed upon her with her pure, faultless soprano voice, and her skill at the pianoforte, and her pretty French, and her reverent Latin, and her exquisite manners, and her royal ways? Though he had already a wife, the courtly governor of the Commonwealth of Virginia wooed Princess Susanna. Though he had already a wife and a young mistress, the master of the largest plantation in the Carolinas wooed Princess Susanna, and loving no man, she loved all, and loving all, she loved no man. traveling through 1775 and early 76 as a house guest in one great mansion after another, hinting at royal patronage to the happy few who succeeded in pleasing her. "We are royalty who comport ourselves as such," was Princess Susanna's gentle catechism to all wealthy commoners, who were privileged to offer their guest gifts of a feminine sort, pearls, jewels, and gold trinkets primarily, but dared not offend by offering outright bribes. Then it happened in the spring of 1776, in one of the great houses in Charleston, Princess Susanna was exposed as Sarah Wilcox, outlaw bondwoman and suspected murderess. Now, did French avail her? It did not. And did Latin avail her? It did not. Nor her pretty little white Bible, nor the locket around her neck with the likeness of the queen inside, nor her pure, unwavering soprano voice, nor all her tales of court. Yet though she was manacled and subdued and weakened and much abused by her captors, the outlaw escaped while being transported north, and none knew where she had gone, unless it was into the very air. Now God had mercy on a poor youth named Durham. Now a pale young seamstress named Bethany. Now Susanna Shepherd, widow. Now Sarah Licht, widow, 26 years of age, childless, of Bush Creek, Maryland, engaged in the autumn of 76 to a young British officer, Lieutenant William Ward of the 16th Light Dragoons, soon to perish at Trenton. And did Sarah love him? She did not. And did she mourn him? Not for an hour. For she had her dying baby to mourn, burning with fever, misshapen head, tiny fingers and toes webbed together. She had crazed weeping Sarah to mourn, running with a drunken mob in Contrecoeur, torches and pitchforks and rifles, hunting Tory traitors to the death. She would set the new world to flame, she cried, as if it were the old. There was Mrs. William Ward, widow, a governess in the Vanderpool household, dismissed after 6 months' service for insolence, impiety, and suspected theft. There was Mrs. Sarah Ward, a country midwife, shrewd and close-mouthed, said to be of the devil's tribe, who never failed at a birth and never rejoiced at a birth, baptizing mother and babe alike with her black, bitter tears. "What seek ye, Sarah? Why with such passion?" So Sarah's own mother admonished her, appearing one night by Sarah's bedside. But she paid no heed, for it was not yet her time. She fluffed out her thinned hair and slapped color into her cheeks and gave her heart to a dashing young man named MacReady, a black-bearded young horse thief from Philadelphia. "Come with me, Sarah Wilcox, and do my will, Sarah." His eyes sly and slanted as her own, his face flushed with love. He could lift her in one arm if he wished. He could smother her in the bulk of his body if he wished. And Sarah cried, "Yes, yes," and curled like a babe in his bosom. Would she cut her shining hair for him? She would. Would she dress in men's clothing for him? She would. Would she follow him into the countryside, into the hills, seeking plunder where plunder might be sought? She would. She would. She wept for very joy. She gave him all the gold she had. She followed where he led her, close upon the heels of the British at Valley Forge, close upon the heels of the Americans at Jockey Hollow, where many a stray horse might be haltered and traded for cash. The war for independence was many wars. The horses knew no allegiance to King or to General Washington. Why thus should Sarah and her lover? For it is foolish to starve when one might feast. It is foolish to die when one might live. And why support a war, MacReady said, if one might be supported by it? Such fine horses to be had for the taking, albeit starving and frostbitten and gun-shy and wary of mankind. And Sarah clutched at her tall, dashing, black-bearded lover as she had never clutched at any man. Yes, yes, Sarah wept. Morristown in Powhatassee, and the doomed British encampment at Port Oriskany. And one day MacReady was shot down by moonlight and died streaming blood in Sarah's arms. Could he die like a dog in a ditch, streaming blood, though Sarah loved him and would have died in his place? He could. He could, in Sarah's very arms, though God looked down and observed the lover's agony. Sarah flees to the north. Sarah flees to the south. It is the year 1780. It is the early winter of 81. She is hunted down in old Muirkirk. She must die in the wilds of Muirkirk Swamp. Years ago, she lost Princess Susanna's gold locket. It has been years since she had gold coins to toss at the horse's hooves. She cannot plead with the soldiers in Latin. They will not pause to hear her pretty, lisping French. God himself is deaf to all her pleas. The first lieutenant fires. The second lieutenant fires. Sarah is a great-winged, soaring egret, but the terrible shot tears through her breast. She is a leaping doe, but the shot tears through her throat. Will you not have mercy, my lord, on one of royal blood? But the shot tears through her heart, even as the soldiers marvel cursing at the woman's strength, and dare not pursue her into the marsh on horseback or afoot. How quickly the horse thief runs, how alive, how desperate. Even as she staggers in agony, her blood cascading from her, even as the shots tear into her back, Sarah Wilcox, who cannot be killed, Sarah Licht, who cannot be run to earth, Sarah MacReady, now sinking into the soft black muck, how alive, the devil's own. Even as the soldiers fire at her fallen body and fire yet again and again with curses of exultation. And now Sarah is dead, surely, in the spring of 1781? And the great trackless swamp swallows her up. 1. Midnight Sun. 1. Do I doubt? I do not. Does my hand shake? It does not. Am I like other men? I am not. He smiles at his ruddy mirrored reflection, that paragon of manhood, a gentleman in the prime of life. Deep-set mica chip eyes sly with secrets, glowing with interior heat, he smiles, and it is a smile. It satisfies him. Though the flushed, muscled cheeks would clench in rage to reveal too many strong, wet, white teeth. Too many strong, wet, white teeth. Am I to be trusted? I am. Am I a gentleman? I am. He pauses in his robust lathering of his cheeks and jaws. He examines a three-quarters profile, the left, the truly striking side of his face. Hums several bars of Mozart, Don Giovanni in the guise of Don Ottavio, examines the smile again, measured, perfectly calibrated, now a slight modest downturning of the eye, an inclination of the head as well. A gentleman who wears his power lightly, who does not insist, a gentleman stallion, assuredly not a gelding, who exhibits his charms sparingly, the very essence of A. Washburn Freelicht, Ph.D. Am I like other men? I am not. He completes his toilet with a flourish and flings down the soapy towel, noting with admiration the light flush of the clean-shaven cheeks, the perpetual fever of the cheeks, noting with awe the hard, hard bones, his inheritance that press against the flesh. His. Why, it is all his. Do I doubt? I do not. Does my hand shake? It does not. Am I eager for it all to begin? Yes, yes, a hundredfold yes. 2. This day of legend or of infamy. To be spoken of, written of, speculated upon, recalled with perennial controversy in the annals of American horse racing and gambling circles well into the 21st century. Derby Day of 11 May 1909 at resplendent Chautauqua Downs, one of the first of the playing fields of the rich. At Chautauqua at that time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.